Hi, this is Dr. Claire, and this is our lecture on animal reproduction. I think this is a really fun topic, partly because I did my PhD on reproductive behavior in birds. So if you want to talk about bird reproduction sometime, you can stop by. I pretty much can talk about that forever. But I'm not going to focus too much about birds in this particular lecture. We're going to start, however, with talking about the different types of reproductive strategies that animals might have. One thing that animals can do is that they can either reproduce sexually or they can reproduce asexually. Now, most animals reproduce sexually all the time. So there's a male, there's a female, there's a combination of gametes, and you get offspring that are genetically diverse from their parents, right? But some species can reproduce asexually, where it's just the one individual and they produce offspring that are identical to themselves. And some animals can actually switch back and forth between these two strategies, depending on the environmental conditions. So if the environment is very stable, oftentimes it's beneficial to reproduce asexually, because if you're a good fit for that environment and you produce clones of yourself through asexual reproduction, then your offspring will likely be a good fit for that environment as well, and you don't have to spend all the energy finding a mate. You're passing on more of your genes because your offspring are clones of you, and it's generally a very successful strategy. But if the environment is very variable, if it changes over time, then although your particular combination of genes might be good right now, in the future they might not be good. So if you go through sexual reproduction, you combine your genes with another individual and your offspring are very diverse, and that allows them to survive in a wider variety of different environments. So in a variable environment, oftentimes sexual reproduction is more successful. And honestly, most environments are variable. So we do tend to see a fair amount of sexual reproduction in animals as well. So let's take a couple, take a look at some examples of asexual reproduction. So these are, again, when the animals are basically producing clones of themselves. On the left here, we have a sea star. And this particular species of sea star can regenerate a whole sea star from a piece of an arm. And so if they get chopped up, then they basically just build new sea stars from those remaining arms. That is actually was a problem in coral reefs. There's a type of sea star known as the crown of thorns star that's a major coral predator. And humans were looking at the reef, seeing them damaged by these stars, and they thought, okay, well, we're going to help out the coral reefs. We're going to remove some of these sea stars from the reef. And so they went down with scuba gear, they brought up the sea stars, and they chopped them up into little pieces, and they threw the pieces back into the ocean, and each of those pieces regenerated into a new sea star, and there was this giant sea star overpopulation boom that really damaged the coral. So it's important that you understand how animals reproduce when you're trying to control problem animals. On the other side, we have a hydra. Hydra is like a sea anemone. It's a type of related to jellyfish. And they can actually reproduce asexually by budding, where basically just a baby grows off the side of the parent. So it's basically like having, you know, a clone of yourself just kind of grow out of your side, and eventually it will separate off and go become a separate individual. So that's their normal mode of reproduction. They can actually reproduce sexually as well. All right, so let's look at some other interesting reproductive strategies. Some vertebrates can actually reproduce asexually through what's called parthenogenesis. In parthenogenesis, the female lays an unfertilized egg, and that egg develops normally into a adult without any contribution of sperm from a male. So females can basically just replenish themselves. In Jurassic Park, the original Jurassic Park, if you are old enough to have seen that, they discover that the dinosaurs, which are supposedly all female, start laying parthenogenic eggs that develop into young towards the end of that movie. But there are some actual live animals. In Colorado, we have a species of whiptail here called the checkered whiptail, which is a parthenogenic lizard. This is not the exact same species here pictured, but it is a similar species. And in that particular species, females lay eggs. The eggs develop normally into adults. There are no males in the population, and females do not need a male to reproduce. However, they have to still have the hormonal cycles in order to reproduce, and that hormonal cycle is triggered by certain behaviors. So other females will actually act as a male and go through the reproductive behaviors kind of mimicking what a male would do, and that triggers the female who's acting as a female to lay eggs, and then later the female who was acting as a male will then act as a female, and then she'll lay eggs. So it's kind of an interesting system. Some species are hermaphroditic, meaning they are both male and female simultaneously, so they have produced both eggs and sperm. When those individuals reproduce, that's not asexual reproduction because you are combining genetic material from two individuals. So that's a type of sexual reproduction. It's just a type of sexual reproduction in which individuals are both male and female. One great example of that is many snails and slugs. The picture here is a couple of banana slugs going through mating. And in this particular case, both slugs are contributing sperm to the other slug. So they're fertilizing, simultaneously fertilizing each other's eggs. There's some even stranger things out there. There are some species that don't stay the same sex their whole life. They actually will change sex over the course of their life. They'll start out as one sex and become another over time. One great example of this is the clownfish. So clownfish live in sea anemones in groups. And in the group that's living in the sea anemone, the largest fish in the group is always the female. The second largest fish is the male, and the other fish don't have a determined sex. So when the male and the female will reproduce and they'll lay eggs and the whole group will help to tend the young. If the female were to die, the male then would become the female. So it actually changes sex, it becomes a female, and then the next largest fish in the group becomes the male. And so the biggest fish is always the female, regardless of whether it was a male in the past or not. The take-home story is that in the movie Finding Nemo, what should have happened when Nemo's mom died at the beginning of the movie is that Nemo's dad should have become Nemo's mom. And that, I think, would have been interesting. So instead of being Marlin, he should have been Marlena for the rest of the movie. Okay. He could still find Nemo. He's still his parent, but, yeah, just different. All right. So let's keep on with sex determination here for a minute. What determines whether an individual is a male or female actually varies between a lot of different species. So in the case of the clownfish, it depends on whether you're the biggest fish in the anemone or not. Other species, like many reptiles and fish, have temperature sensitive determination. So turtles actually can determine the sex of their offspring depending on whether they lay in a sunny spot or a shady spot. Warmer eggs will develop into one sex and cooler eggs will develop into another. Some species have genetically determined sexes. So as humans, we have sex determination via chromosome. So males have an X and a Y chromosome, and females have an X and an X chromosome. Birds are actually the opposite. In birds, the females have two different chromosomes. So females have, they name them differently. Females have what's called a W chromosome and a Z chromosome, and males are ZZ. So the females have two different chromosomes and the males have two of the same. So it's opposite of mammals, which is kind of interesting. All right, so if you're going through sexual reproduction, you need to get sperm to the egg somehow, right? So they need to be fertilized. If you're an aquatic species, you're living in this nice watery environment, you can actually just release your sperm into the water and have it float around and fertilize eggs that happen to be there. This is called external fertilization. In the case of many sea animals or aquatic animals that don't move, like coral is an animal. The individual corals within a colony, a whole thing that you would call a coral is actually a colony with a whole bunch of different animals. They can't move to breed. So what they do is that they actually release sperm and eggs into the water on a particular night of the year. So it's usually, I believe, the full moon in October is when the coral spawns. And so all of the corals on this full moon night in October will release their sperm and eggs. It'll float around in the water and the sperm will swim around and find eggs. The eggs actually release chemicals that help the sperm to find the eggs, and they'll fertilize the eggs, and that's how that works. So this picture here is spawning coral. Other things have a little bit more directed reproduction, still external fertilization. So a lot of fishes, the female will lay her eggs and then the male will swim over them and release sperm to fertilize the eggs outside of the body of the female. So external fertilization is very common in aquatic species. In terrestrial species, you got a little bit of a problem because terrestrial species have to deal with dehydration of the sperm and the eggs, and you can't just release things into a terrestrial environment and expect them to find each other. It's not going to happen. So terrestrial animals have a few different adaptations that allow them to survive outside of the water. One is that terrestrial animals tend to have, particularly terrestrial vertebrates, have what's called an amniotic egg. And an amniotic egg is an egg that contains all the water that the embryo needs in order to survive, and it's surrounded by a membrane called the amnion that keeps all that water inside. So birds and reptiles have this amniotic egg that does not need external water in order to survive. Things like amphibians have to lay their eggs in the water because they don't have an amniotic egg. Also, terrestrial animals have internal fertilization, where the sperm is introduced directly into the female's reproductive tract and fertilization occurs there. So if you have internal fertilization, there's a couple different ways that you can proceed with the development of the offspring. If you can be what's called oviparous. So oviparity is when fertilization occurs inside the female, but then the fertilized eggs are deposited outside the mother's body and development happens outside the mother's body. So anything that you think of on land that's laying an egg, you know, turtles, lizards, butterflies, birds, those are all oviparous animals. Fertilization occurs inside and then the egg is laid. You can have ovoviviparity. That is when fertilization occurs inside. There is an egg that is contained within the body and it develops inside the body, but the female doesn't really contribute resources to that egg while it's in her body. It just develops in there and then she gives birth to live young later. So there's a lot of ovoviparous snakes. There are some ovoviparous fish. This here is a really interesting, the seahorse is a really interesting, the one that's boxed in red here, really interesting ovoviparous animal, because in the seahorse, the female, rather than the male internally fertilizing the female lays her eggs into a pouch in the male's stomach, and then the male fertilizes the eggs within his own stomach with his sperm, and then the baby seahorses develop inside the male's stomach, and then he births live baby seahorses. So that's ovoviviparity. It's a big one. There's a lot of V's in there. And then last is viviparity, and that's when you give live birth, but the young develop within the mother and obtain nourishment from the mother during development. So mammals are your classic example of that group. So, you know, your dolphins, your elephants, your dogs, cats, humans are all viviparous. So fertilization occurs inside, and then the fetus is nourished by the mother's bloodstream during development. So it's not like there's an egg that is self-contained that is within the mother. It's actual, there's actual exchange of nutrients between the mother and the offspring. Okay? All right. So these different breeding systems have actually evolved in a whole bunch of separate times. So when you look at your terrestrial vertebrates, this is invertebrates only. When you look at your terrestrial vertebrates here, there is an evolution of internal fertilization once in the terrestrial vertebrates as a group. So your reptiles, birds, and mammals are all internal fertilization. But there have been some cases where live birth has also evolved. So within the snakes, as I said, there's a bunch of those, and also in the mammals. So that's one group. And then if you look in amphibians and fish, internal fertilization has actually evolved a bunch of times in amphibians and fish, and live birth has evolved a bunch of times in amphibians and fish as well. All right, so if you're going to go ahead and have internal fertilization, you have to transfer the sperm some way. And I'm sure you know about how sperm transfer works in mammals, so I'm going to tell you some other interesting sperm transfer mechanisms for internal fertilization. So many insects have what's called a nuptial gift. This is a glob of sperm and carbohydrates and proteins that is developed by the male, and it is inserted into the female's cloaca. This is a female here who's received a nuptial gift from a male. That nuptial gift will feed the female at the same time as she is accepting the sperm to fertilize her eggs. And so the bigger the nuptial gift is, the more energy the female has to produce eggs and the more offspring the male can have. So that's the thing that's going on there. Most birds reproduce through what's called a copulate through what's called a cloacal kiss. A cloacal kiss, basically, birds have a single opening that goes to the digestive system, the reproductive system, and the excretory system. One opening, that's why we call it a cloaca. Otherwise, you have separate different openings, and then they have different names. But if it's all one opening, you call it a cloaca. And so basically, most birds don't have a sperm transfer organ of any type. And so they basically just bump their cloacas together, and the male will transfer the sperm, and the female will take it up. The females pretty much have to cooperate for that to happen. And it's very, very fast. So if you ever see a bird jump on another bird and then jump off again like a second later and then they all both flutter their wings, you've just seen two birds copulate. It's very quick. Some birds do have a sperm transfer organ, though. For example, this is a ruddy duck here. And the ruddy duck has a long corkscrew-shaped penis. So ducks live in the water, and the cloacal kiss doesn't work so well in the water because the water will wash the sperm away. So they actually do have a penis that they can avert from their cloaca when they need to reproduce, and then they take it back up when they don't, and it's not visible most of the time. The longest penis in the animal world actually is possessed by the barnacle. Barnacles are hermaphroditic, meaning they are both male and female, and rather than fertilizing externally, like many aquatic organisms, they fertilize internally, but they can't move because they're barnacles. And so in order to fertilize internally, they have to reach a neighbor who's reproductively receptive. So if you look at this picture here, this little white line there, that is a barnacle penis, and the barnacle penis can reach around to several other individuals in the general vicinity. So this individual is reaching out and inseminating this individual over there. They're the largest in the animal kingdom because they are several times the length of the animal themselves. It's not a very large animal, but, you know, it's a compared to the body size, it's a very, very long penis. Some animals have very interesting shaped penis. This is a possum penis here. Female possums have two uteruses, each with their own ovary. And so if you're a male possum and you want to fertilize the eggs in both uteruses, you need a forked penis so that you can simultaneously inseminate both uteruses at the same time. And so that's indeed what they have. So there's some interesting reproductive systems. Hopefully I didn't freak you out too much, and I'll catch you guys next time.